Many old games used paper and passwords to save and load the game. I am Bisqwit, and in this series we crack video game password generators. The Guardian Legend is a recognizably Japanese game, where the main character is a scantily clad robot girl wearing a mechanical suit with wings. It is essentially a hybrid between a role-playing game, a space shooter game, and an action-adventure game. It also has some of the most beautiful music that the NES has to offer. In the previous episode I promised another lesson in apostrophes, and here we have it, the password system. For some reason the lowercase letters all have a diaresis accent to them. I guess that the Japanese guys think that the Latin letters look too naked without some decodens. Contrary to reverse it ransom, however, this diaresis is nothing but a visual effect, and makes it easier to tell apart the uppercase and lowercase letters. In general, the font is very well designed for clarity. So, here is the password alphabet as laid out on the password screen. There are 64 symbols and they directly correspond to numbers in that same order. I am ignoring the space because it's just the same as the capital A. Let's reorganize the view a bit so we get nice round numbers. With 64 different symbols we have 6 bits of information per letter, because each additional bit multiplies the number of options by 2, and 2 raised to the 6th power is 64. The password is 32 symbols long, twice as long as in Simon's Quest. This brings the data capacity of the password into 192 bits, or 24 bytes. When I made the River City Ransom episode, someone commented asking whether that's the first game in the series to use Base64. Well, River City Ransom doesn't use Base64, but the Garden Legend does. Sort of. Let's study how Base64 works. As we established earlier, each letter in the password is a 6-bit integer. They are made of 6 bits. 4 of these 6-bit letters together make up 24 bits. 24 bits can also be divided into 3 groups of 8 bits. In Base64, groups of 4 6-bit letters are transformed into 3 8-bit bytes. Let's study how that works. First we take the 6 bits from the first letter and place them in the first byte. That leaves 2 bits in the first byte. The 2 bits are taken from the second letter and placed starting at the 6th bit position. That leaves 4 bits in the second letter. The 4 bits, which start at bit position 2, are placed in the second byte. That leaves 4 bits in the second byte. The 4 bits are taken from the 3rd letter and placed starting at the 4th bit position. That leaves 2 bits in the 3rd letter. The 2 bits, which start at bit position 4, are placed in the 3rd byte. That leaves 6 bits in the 3rd byte. The 6 bits are taken from the 4th letter and placed starting at bit position 2. The same process is repeated for all groups of 3 bytes. On the screen you can see some pseudocode for converting letters into bytes. You can also do the same in reverse, convert bytes into letters. Once you have done this for all the 8 groups of 4 letters in the password, you have this table of 24 bytes of data. Now at this point I want to make it clear that I was not the first person to crack this password system. The research was first done in 2004 by TNSC, who told me all that he knows back then. He also did Solar Jetman and a few other games I haven't even covered so far. There is also a guide at GameFAQs by Fat Rat Knight dated 2005, but it has some errors in it. For the sake of this video, I redid all the research from scratch, just in case those guys missed something. The first points of interest in this table are the checksum and the encryption data. In fact, we must understand the encryption if we are to do anything at all. The encryption algorithm is a simple reversible XOR with a key that is generated incrementally from a single 8-bit key. A particularly interesting detail is the fact that when the game encrypts the password, it actually runs the encryption for 30 bytes of data, while the password data is actually much shorter. Maybe the password had a different format previously in the development history, or maybe the developer lost their track of thought and made a mistake in their code. Here is the checksum calculation code. Now here is an exercise for you. Can you figure out what the code does? take some paper and pen and write down your analysis in pseudocode. I will give you 5 seconds, but you can pause the video. Start writing. Time starts now. Chances are the code you came up with looks something like this. Is it correct? No, it's not. When you do additions on the 6502, you are supposed to make sure the carry is clear before you make addition by using the CLC instruction. But here, the CLC instruction is actually outside the loop. It is only executed once. You have to simulate the carry addition to replicate what the code does. So, exercise number 2. Is this code correct or not? Pause the video and study it. I will give you 5 seconds. Make sure you can explain your reasoning. So, is the code correct or not? Nope, it's not. Why? Because these carry additions are sensitive to the order of the calculations. You cannot change the order and expect correct results. Here is how the code must be changed. This is one of the correct possible translations for that deceptively simple looking assembler code. There are a few other ways to write it, but unlike how I did in the Solar Jetman video, this time I wasn't able to find an expression that avoids having to mention the sum variable twice in the expression. By the way, I wonder why they wrote the encryption and decryption code so differently.
This sentence intentionally left blank because of editing reasons.
It is like different people were working on those parts, and a few hot fixes were later applied to make sure they matched. Here is a map of the contents of the password. The first 70 bytes are directly copied between the actual game RAM and the password data. It may look confusing because of the view holes, but that's just the data that will be substituted later. Ignore that. Most of these 70 bytes are bits. Bits that indicate whether something is done somewhere or not. For clarity, here's the map of the game. And here is an overlay that indicates if this bit is set in the password, an item has been collected in this room and can no longer be collected. In this overlay are bits that indicate whether a boss has been beaten in a certain room. This overlay shows bits that affect how information displays are rendered and whether there's a shop in that screen. Finally, here's the list of rooms that contain a corridor. Each corridor is open if the bit corresponding to that number is set in the password. You may be wondering about the suspiciously large number of corridors here. We will get back to this later. Within those 17 bytes, there is also the list of weapons you have, the list of keys you have, and the amount of ammo you have. As far as I know, bit 22 is never used. Bit 0 is also doubtful. The game also forces the high order of bits in bytes 14 and 16 to 0, and halves of bytes 8 and 11 are overwritten with other things. One of these things is the chip level. The chip level, the fire rate, the maximum attack, and the shield level are special in that they are actually stored in the password in a bit reversed format. There is also the maximum life, the x coordinate, and the y coordinate, which are not stored in the bit reversed format. The score is saved in 2.5 bytes in a most peculiar format. The score in this game has a range of 10 million. However, the last digit is always 0, so the actual range is just a million. This means 6 digits. Now in the past, we have seen that whenever the game saves a score or money or other large number into the password, it saves each digit individually. This means that for a 6-digit number, 6 times 4 bits would be required, i.e. 3 bytes. However, in The Guardian Legend, there's only room for 2.5 bytes for the score, 20 bits. If the password was saved in a binary number, it would actually take exactly 20 bits. But the game doesn't actually save the score in binary. Well, it kinda does, kinda doesn't. Here's what it actually does. The score is first divided into two groups of 3 digits. Now both groups are stored individually as binary numbers. Each group makes up a 10-bit binary number, and then both these binary numbers are stored in the password, low 8 bits in one place, and the upper 2 bits in another place. However, the upper two bits have their bits reversed for some odd reason. Now I know what you are thinking, but the bit reversal is not an intentional measure of obfuscation. It is a consequence of the peculiar way that the game shifts bits from one byte into another byte. Suppose we have two 8-bit variables called target and input. We want to merge some bits from both of those variables into a single variable. We also have the carry flag and the A register in the processor. The bits we don't care about are illustrated in wonky symbols. Here is how most programmers would do it. First, they shift the target byte to the left by 3 bits to make room for the 3 XYZ bits that will be inserted. The byte containing the XYZ bits is loaded into the accumulator for processing. The high 5 bits are cleared with an AND operation. And then these two bytes are merged with an OR operation. The result is stored into the target. That's how most programmers would do it. But here is how the Guardian Legend does it. First, the input byte is taken into the accumulator. Then, the low order bit is moved into the carry flag. Next, the carry flag is pushed into the target byte. And this is repeated 3 times for all 3 bits. As a result, target now contains the 5 original bits and the 3 bits we wanted to put into it. The method that TGL uses is both faster and shorter than the normal way to do it, but it does reverse the order of the bits compared to the canonical way to do it. Now the final data item on the list is the coordinates. Here is the game map as we saw it earlier. The first interesting observation is that nearly half of the map is actually blank. Well, that is an understatement actually. Remember that the coordinates are both 5-bit and have a range of 32. Well, actually they are 8-bit and have a range of 256. The actual game region is just a tiny portion of the space the player can roam in. But in the password, you can enter 5-bit coordinates. And yes, you can go anywhere you want with the custom password. So what's in those empty slots? All those empty slots within the 2424 window are either corridors or save screens, but they may also contain passages that lead outside the 2424 window. Outside this 2424 window, things are not so trivial. To explain what I mean, have a look at this code. This is a summary of what the game actually does when it locates the data for a particular room. If the Y coordinate is 24 or greater, this will just access data from out of bounds, probably pulling data from random memory addresses. But if the X coordinate is 24 or greater, this loop actually never terminates. It stands to reason that if you try to go into such a room, the game would softlock itself. In fact, that is what usually happens, but not always. Can you figure out why? There is also this special password, TGL, but everyone knows that. The game itself gives it away. Let's jump to the password encoder and decoder. I wrote this one in C++. So anyway, that covers most of what there is to know about the passwords of the English version of the Guardian Legend. I am Bisqwit. Check out other episodes of this series. Making these cracking videos for games with huge passwords takes a huge amount of time. So next time we will see a game with a bit shorter password.